Hey, I have an eye patient that I was hoping you could help me out with. A 2 day onset, right eye discomfort, blurry vision, some light sensitivity. I was hoping you'd come in to help me out with this patient. Visual acuity, blurry. I'm Dr. Jasper Trotter, board certified ophthalmologist, and in this video, we're gonna simplify visual acuity. Break down what does 20/20 even mean, how to use an eye chart. I didn't put it up yet. What to do if you don't have an eye chart like right now. Checking a patient's visual acuity is a really important part of the eye exam. It gives you a lot of information and it also helps to delineate, is this something that is urgent or maybe something that is more stable that can wait through the night or whatever the time frame is. So anytime you're seeing an eye patient, get that visual acuity. Visual acuity measures how sharp your vision is at a distance, specifically your central vision. So it's not checking your peripheral vision, but the patient's central vision. And in ophthalmology notes, you may see, yes, we use a lot of acronyms. Visual acuity, you may see notated as VA in an ophthalmology note. So now you got one of the acronyms. You may have seen visual acuity notated as two numbers, a numerator and a denominator. So the top number, the numerator, that's the distance that the patient stands from the eye chart. And in the US, that's in feet. The bottom number is the lowest row that a patient can see on the eye chart. So let's say we have two patients. Patient A has 20/20 visual acuity, and patient B has 20/60 visual acuity. So let's say both patients are standing 20 feet away from the eye chart. Let's imagine that it's to the left of me. So a patient with 20/20 visual acuity can stand 60 feet from the eye chart and see the same target as this patient that has 20/60 visual acuity that's still at 20 feet. Another example, let's say you're seeing a patient with 20/20 vision in the right eye and 20/100 vision in the left eye. If you're just checking the 20/20 eye, I could be standing at 20 feet away from the eye chart and I can see the 20/20 line. But if we switch and check the left eye at 20 feet, I can't see the 20/20 line. I can't see the 20/40 line. This eye is 20/100. So the lowest I can go to is the 20/100 line. Now, if we switch back to the right eye, that's the 20/20 eye, I could stand all the way 100 feet and back and see the same that this eye would see at 20 feet. And the higher the number, the worse the vision is. So normal vision is considered to be 20/20. So someone's seeing 20/15, well, that's better. 15, that's smaller than 20. That is better than normal vision. Compare that to someone with 20/80 vision. They have worse vision than 20/20. So the higher the number, the worse the vision is. What do you need to check visual acuity? Well, commonly this is going to be a Snellen eye chart, and that helps to check the distance vision. But you can also check near vision by using a near card, which is also called a pocket eye chart. Now, let's say you don't have access to a Snellen eye chart, you don't have a near card that you can just pull out of your backpack. What do? You can download an app that has a visual acuity chart, and oftentimes it'll tell you how far the phone needs to be from the patient. So the visual acuity isn't just blurry. The second thing that's helpful to have when checking visual acuity is a pinhole occluder. So you may see these things at eye clinics, but they're actually really helpful to have, especially if you see urgent patients or you're in the primary care setting. You never know when an eye patient's gonna come through. I'll leave a link down below if you wanna check them out. Even if you see eye patients infrequently, it would be good to have at least one available to use, because these help with two main things. One, you wanna check one eye at a time. So if you're checking the right eye first, and this goes over the nose, this is blocking the left eye. So I don't have to worry about somebody cheating. The second way that it's helpful is it helps to estimate how much the vision could improve with correction. What I mean by correction is glasses or contact lenses. So let's go through the process of how to check visual acuity. To start, you want to have good lighting. You don't want it to be too dim or dark because you can't see in the dark. Ask the patient if they wear glasses or contact lenses. If they're a contact lens wearer, chances are they may already be wearing them unless it's a trauma where a contact lens came out or maybe they took them out before coming in. But if they wear glasses and they have them with them, have them put them on. So the goal is to see what is the best corrected visual acuity. Now, if you're an ophthalmologist or an optometrist, you're in training, there are times where we do want to know what the uncorrected visual acuity is, where the patient is not wearing contact lenses, not wearing glasses, but that's not what we're talking about right now. We're talking about really focusing on, pun intended, focusing on what their best corrected visual acuity is. And it'll save you time if you do that from the beginning before you go through checking the visual acuity. Now, the way that I think about this is, although we have two eyes, treat each eye separately. So you want to check one eye at a time. If you don't check the visual acuity separately and you have the patient use both of their eyes to check the visual acuity, they may be 20/20, but you could be missing the fact that the right eye is 20/20, but the left eye, which is where maybe they're having the problem, maybe they're 21/50. But because the right eye is so strong, the patient is relying on the right eye. So it can give a false representation of what's really going on. So you want to temporarily occlude the eye that you're not testing. Now, one way you can do that, this is where the pinhole comes back up. Let's say we're checking the right eye first, patient's wearing the glasses. This can come up, just goes over the nose. And now the left eye is being occluded and the patient's just utilizing their right eye. If you don't have a pinhole occluder or any other way to occlude the eye safely, you can have the patient use their hand, but just make sure that they're not peeking through. And one way you can have them use their palm and have them cup the palm rather than a flat hand, because sometimes, especially if a patient's nervous, they may be pressing on the eye. And if you're pressing on the eye, that can temporarily blur the vision. So let's go through the eye chart. So instead of having the patient start at the very top letter, the big letter, which is often an E, and then working their way down, that takes a hot minute. Instead, what I've adopted is I tell the patient to jump to the lowest line that they can see. So instead of going E, F, P, T, have them jump all the way, because what if the patient can see the 20/25 line? You just skipped all of this. Okay. And so if they can jump to the 20/25 line, they're going to read through the line. Now, how do you know if they're actually 20/25? The patient needs to see at least three letters. And this is when we're getting down to getting to the rows that have at least three letters. So a patient needs to see at least three letters in the row in order to qualify for that visual acuity. Now, here's a little mnemonic. When they see three, they can see. Now, let's say a patient was able to read the 20/50 line without problem, but once they got down to the 20/40 line, they were only able to see the last letter. So they got one letter on the 20/40 line, they got all the letters on the 20/50 line, so they got 20/50 plus. So they got a little bit more, but they didn't get at least three letters on the 20/40 line, so they don't qualify for 20/40. They're 20/50 plus one. Now, when you're checking visual acuity, I bet you didn't think you'd have to be a coach. What I mean by that is sometimes patients don't want to do the test, or they're uncomfortable, they're in pain, or they're just going to tell you, I can't see anything, and they're making eye contact with you. So sometimes you got to coach them through it. You got to push them to really try to get what the best corrected visual acuity is. So what I'll have them do is, instead of just, you know, taking the near card from them or just saying, okay, we're done, I want them to try. And so I'll tell them, give it a shot, even if you're guessing, what does the first letter look like? And many times they get it. And then I cheer them on and then have them keep going. And that could be a difference of, you know, improving the visual acuity two lines, even if they're slowly going through it. And sometimes I'll literally document VA visual acuity 20/25 parentheses slow. As a quick side note, you may hear a patient say that they have double vision while checking visual acuity. People tend to be pretty focused when doing this test and can forget to blink. So have them blink a few times in a row. If the double vision is due to dryness, that'll help eradicate it and clear things up. The next thing you check is, can they count fingers? So if you were my patient, I would ask you, how many fingers do you see? Two, three, okay. So you have counting fingers visual acuity. And let's say that I am about 3 feet from you. So I would notate that as visual acuity is counting fingers, or CF, at 3 feet. If a patient isn't able to count fingers, then the next thing to check is hand motion. So the way that I check hand motion is, still with one eye occluded, I ask the patient, what am I doing? So I purposely am not saying which direction am I moving my hand, because if the patient is able to detect hand motion with their vision, then they can see that there's some motion. They may not be able to see that it's my hand, But even if they say you're moving something from left to right, and then it's matching the direction. Or, you know, if you're not quite sure, then go a different direction. And sometimes patients can literally use their hand to show which direction you're moving your hand at. Make sure that your hand is not too close to the face when you're checking hand motion, because the movement can bring a drift. And now the patient can just guess that you're moving your hand or doing something from left to right because they can feel it. If a patient can't tell hand motion, then the next thing to check is light perception. So now you're at a point where the vision is pretty poor. So you want to know whether or not the patient can detect light. So it's really important, especially here, to make sure that the other eye is completely occluded, because what you don't want, if the left side is occluded, if you're shining a light, that some of the light actually comes through and the patient can see the light through the other eye, and they're, you know, maybe genuinely saying, yes, I see light, but not realizing it's coming from the better seeing eye. To check light perception, use a bright light source, and I'll list some examples on the screen. If you don't have any of these, when in doubt, what you could do is use a flashlight on your phone. Remember, this doesn't have to be perfect. You basically want to get a general idea of the patient's visual acuity. When seeing if a patient can detect light, I try not to ask the patient, can you see the light? Because that implies that you're shining a light on the eye and it opens the door to a patient guessing or just saying that they do when they may not actually see the light. Fear is very powerful, and a patient may want to be able to see the light, or maybe they think they are seeing the light, but they actually aren't. Instead, I'll tell the patient to tell me when they see the light. Maybe I'll do a separate video that goes more in depth about checking light perception, because it's actually pretty important to delineate no light perception from light perception, etc. But for this specific video, let's pretend that this is a pen light and you're my patient and I'm checking to see if you can detect light. Tell me when you can see the light. See it? No, if you didn't say anything while I had the light source on, then I'm starting to think maybe you can't see it. It's not consistent, right? So I may even say, well, can you see it now? And I'm purposely not shining the light on the eye to see, one, if you're guessing, two, to try to figure out, are you able to see the light? And it may even get to the point where I just shine the light on and I'm waiting for you to say something. Don't be afraid to reproduce your findings. If a patient isn't able to detect light, then they have no light perception or NLP visual acuity. What should you do if you don't have access to a Snellen chart or a near card right this moment and you have a patient? Well, for one, you can press pause and I'll put a link down below. You can order one of these near cards and just put it in your bag or whatever. So that way you're not in that situation again. But let's say you don't have any way to check visual acuity. Well, you have access to your fingers, so you can check counting fingers. You can, if you have a light source, you have your phone, chances are you got your phone, you're watching this, okay, that you can check to see if the patient at least detects light. You can also just watch the patient, see how they move around, see how they're going from one room to the next. Are they bumping into things? Are they making eye contact with you? How are they engaging with, maybe they have a guest with them? So the point is, even if you don't have an eye chart available to you, you can get some general information about the patient's vision. If you have any questions about checking visual acuity, go ahead and leave them down below in the comment section. Let's make today a good day, and I'll see you in the next video.